Hello everyone, welcome back. This is 1-5 input methods. I'm MME222 and today we will be discussing on some input methods as suggested by the title. So basically the input devices and how to define as legitimate inputs or legitimate inputs and those stuff, and also some brief discussion on the choice of input devices and location. So although this chapter would be a bit short, but then the last part would still quite be interesting to some people who want to know more about Redstone contraptions and how you would plan for inputs. So without further ado, let's get started. So we start with some simple things where it's literally just what input devices there are. So currently there are 3 accepted input devices for a proper Redstone contraption. They are being stone button, wooden button, and lever. And in case if you forget, buttons, these two, provide a sharp pulse, while a lever will provide a constant signal. And if you really want to check out all of the properties of the buttons and the levers, you should refer to 1-2 properties of Redstone components 2, where I have a more in-depth discussion about buttons and levers. So basically there you have it. Now I would move on to one of the main parts of this video, which is about input legitimacy. Now, for any Redstone contraptions to be considered legit, they must have a legitimate input. The reason for having your contraptions to have a legit input, or even to make your Redstone contraption legitimate, is that you can compare your Redstone contraption with other Redstone contraptions. Because legitimate input is one of the basic rules to have your contraption to be at least comparable to other contraptions. Because if you don't have some basic rules for Redstone contraptions, then they might vary a lot, and it might get very messy to compare one contraption from another contraption. So that's why we would have some basic rules for inputs. Of course, in practical usage, you might not find these such rules very practical. But then, if you are purely here to build Redstone contraptions, Redstone piston doors, or something, and you want to at least compare your skill, or your size, or the speed of your contraption with other people's contraptions, then this is basically the rules that we would usually follow. So this is why having a legitimate input is quite important. Now, there are some rules for a legit input. Although saying those rules out loud would kind of be more straightforward, but then I think that examples would better demonstrate on the rules behind. So here, let's say we have an arbitrary 3x3x3 contraption here. So you see there are 2 levers over here, and these are actually considered not legitimate inputs. But then these 3 levers, for example, they are considered legitimate inputs. Now the reason for that is because these levers here are within the volume of the 3x3x3 contraption, while these 3 levers are not. They are on the exterior of the 3x3x3 volume. So basically, the first rule, you must have a input device, button or lever, to be on the exterior of your Redstone contraption. So that's basically the first rule. The second rule is a bit more specific. So to demonstrate this, I would use a triple piston extender, where I would show you more on triple piston extenders later. So anyways, we will just check out this triple piston extender. So if I press this button, you can see this block actually goes down. But then I need to press this button twice in order to have this piston to retract. If I press the button the third time, you can see it retracts the block, but not fully. But only when I press it 4 times does it retract fully. So essentially it takes two button presses to extend and two button presses to retract. And first, this entire triple piece extender is actually not considered as legit, nor does the input consider as a legitimate input. That's because you need to basically have two button presses for the contraption to work. However, for this one, where if we replace these with a four tick repeater and an observer, you can see it makes a big difference. So one button press, it extends, and the second button press, it actually retracts. So this entire Redstone contraption is actually a legal Redstone contraption. So basically you must only have your input device to be pressed or activated once, such that the contraption does one state, and then when you deactivate it, it does another state. So that's basically the idea behind this rule. The third one is a bit funny. So this is a folder double piece extender, and the left one, you can see there are two input devices. So only if you do the lever and then the stone button, well, it basically do its thing. While this one only uses a lever, one lever, to do its entire thing. Now we would say that this Redstone contraption is not legit, while this one is. This is because this contraption has more than one input device, and this is not allowed for a legitimate Redstone contraption. So you must only have one input device for one Redstone contraption. The fourth one is a bit more arguable, but then basically we want any contraptions to have a block support for your input device. So say if I have a instance repeater here, that maybe for example I would want to have something to power from behind. Now if I only have this lever here as the access of the entire Redstone contraption, then this is actually unlegit, because if I flick it, the block is gone, and first there are no more block supports already, so I need to place it back again, and same for turning it off. So this is considered not legit already for the lever itself. The second one I would take from my previous build, where this one is a 4x4 dream door by me, Ganymede, MHO009, and CraftyMasterman. This door is quite funny, and it's also quite weird. And the main focus is not the door itself, the main focus is the input. Now, we actually have this Redstone line, or I should say these two Redstone dust as the input. So you basically have a repeater here, and then a block here, and a lever here. But then if we only have this here, then you basically cannot even put any input devices, because Redstone dust, you cannot support a lever, of course. And for those of you who are wondering, if I power this dropper, does it work? The answer is no, because you will basically power this Redstone dust, which we don't want. However, you can make this legit by having an extra block here and then a lever here, and now this entire thing is legit. But then this block already causes an increase in the Redstone contraption's volume, so make sure to be aware of that. Now this build itself is actually casual, so we don't expect to compare this build to others, so we don't really care on the legitimacy of the input. But then I would expect everyone to at least follow some input legitimacy rules, such that your Redstone contraptions are actually comparable to others. Now the fifth one is even more confusing. It's related to other things. And if we have this double piece extender here as an example, if I press this button, it actually doesn't extend. Only if I press this button instead. Now if you compare to this one, this button actually also extends. Same for this button. So you see the difference. If I power this circuit directly with this button here, it doesn't work. But if I power it via a repeater, it works. But then for this circuit, if I power it with directly a button, Redstone dust is basically still a direct input, or we say a player input. it still extends. And for a repeater input, of course, it also does extend. Now, we would say that this contraption is not legit because it doesn't have a legitimate input, because powering it via a player input doesn't work. While we will say this Redstone contraption is legitimate because its input devices are legit, as if you power it both with a player or a repeater input, it still works. Now, if you want to learn more about, for example, these triple piece extenders, and okay, so for the triple piece extender, I would basically discuss more of the triple piece extender circuits in 2-6, circuits more on piston extender circuits. And for the folder double extender, I would explain its working principle in 2-1, basic locationality and directionality, so you should check them out. And for this one, it is related to input bug, so if you want to learn more about input bug, you can go ahead and watch 2-4, tick counting, input bug, and more timings. I have already covered those knowledge there, so if you want to learn more, check that out. So that already concludes everything I want to talk about, the legitimacy of inputs. So essentially, there are a few rules. The first rule being it should be on the exterior of the Redstone contraption volume. Second one being you must only have one button press or one lever flick to have the contraption work. The third one being you must only have one input device instead of multiples of them. The fourth one being it should have a block support for the input device. And the fifth one is that it's not affected by input bug. So essentially both player input and repeater input works. So those are all the five rules, if I haven't missed them out. And now I will talk about something a bit more complicated, and that is the choice of input device and location. Now, the choice of input device and location is determined by many factors, such as piston layout, behaviors of usable circuits, circuit accessibility, and etc. These requires planning, and this is actually a more advanced topic, so this actually will be discussed in 2-12, Introduction to Planning and Sequencing, 3-2, Planning, and 3-4, Redstone Analysis. So you can see it ranges from intermediate to advanced topics, and this is actually a bit more complex than you would think. Now, I will try to ignite your interest in such topics by briefly introducing you to the world of, I guess, planning itself via these two doors. So this is a 297 block 5x5 vertical bar door by me. And this one is the 324 block one by me and MHO09. And I would use these doors to explain to you the choice of input devices and locations by some piston layout analysis, as you see at the back, with a brief discussion of planning, basically. So let's get started with the 297 block one. Now, if you see this here, the main focus is actually the bottom part. So we have the sides that will have some slime that will push over. So we basically need the bottom covering piston, I would say, to pull the block down first, such that you can push the slime out. And then when the slime goes back and basically the door opens, you want this bottom covering piston to fire last. So essentially, the bottom covering piston needs to fire early during the closing and fire late during the opening. Now, how do you solve this? There is a nice solution that is to use hopper ROM. So what is a hopper ROM? This is a hopper ROM. I will introduce it a bit later. But anyways, you can, for now, you only need to know that hopper ROM can basically add a lot of delay to a certain edge or certain point of powering, and not adding delay to another edge. So essentially, for example, when I power the lever, this does not have any delay, but when I depower the lever, this adds a lot of delay for the hopper ROM. So this is basically for now what the hopper ROM does. So this can serve as a solution to the timing of the piston. However, this is more related to planning. On the left side, it's actually quite cramped, and it should be used to control the firing of the slime pistons, basically. So a natural solution is to fit the hopper ROM on the right side. So the hopper ROM must be placed on the right side, and we need to basically make it accessible to the left side. And naturally, we want to have these two pistons, which are basically locking this piston from receiving power, to actually be used as the signal transmission to this piston. And essentially, we would basically have, for example, like an observer here. And then why we say it's these two pistons is because we can, for example, have a sticky piston with a redstone block here. First, we would already solve these two pistons, and then we can have an observer here that powers this piston. So that solves these two left bottom singles, but then we also notice that there are still two right bottom singles that remains to be powered. And here, a decision has been made such that you would basically naturally think a lever input would be best in this situation, because not only can you power these two pistons at this location, you can also, for example, have some circuits here to power some hopper ROM, as we have discussed earlier, or established earlier, because we need a hopper ROM for this piston. So we can already do that in here, and it's really helpful. So this is why a lever input would be best, as you consider these two pistons that need constant power, constant signal, and you also want a hopper ROM that can be activated and deactivated. So explains why a lever input, and it's at this block. So that is for the 297 block case. We now would talk about the 324 block case, which actually is slightly simpler, hopefully. Now, comparing this here to this here, you would naturally think that the hardest part is actually the slime here. But then what about this? The hardest part is actually the triple piston extenders. So in that, a more intuitive way to solve this is to place an input device next to the triple piston extenders. Why would we do that? Now, this is actually to avoid any extra signal transmission circuits. We basically, as we are basically going for compactness, we basically want an input device that can access these circuits quickly and directly. So if I place this input somewhere else, you might need to have two redstone torches right here to power this block, which would not be that good, because you basically wasted space for signal transmission, and that's not good. So we usually place an input device directly next to it. And explaining why we use a button now. So very often you will see triple piston extenders are connected to your button inputs, as this allows the back pistons to automatically retract the middle pistons. So if you imagine what will happen is that we will have this here that extends, and then these can do its stuff. So let's say they already extended, and then now we here when during the retraction, we can have the triple piston, the back pistons to retract the middle pistons, such that the middle pistons can now retract other stuff. And same for the opening. So say here we would have these to retract, and then we can again have the back pistons to retract, and then the middle piston to do its stuff, like so. And yeah, basically a button saves us from again powering these back pistons, because otherwise if you have a lever here, you might have something like this, and then when the lever turns off, you have this here. Let's say it already retracts. You need an extra pulse here, and this is not good because you basically need an extra amount of circuitry, extra amount of space to power the back piston circuit. So this is not that good. And having a button here solves our issue of back piston needing to power to retract the middle pistons, and also the doubles actually, because they can also retract the front pistons. So that's why we use a button, basically. And using a button also helps us to allow some repeated sequences that can also help with double and triple piston extenders, because we essentially want something, we want a sequence to be repeatable because it saves us space. And by having a repeatable sequence, it basically means we can do both the extension and retraction with the same circuit power twice, for example. So yeah, basically that. Hopefully that makes a bit sense. And you can also see in this triple piston extender, if I haven't explained that situation clearly, you can see that this here actually pulses twice. So this serves as both the extension and the retraction circuit. You can see the forcing repeater is actually powered twice. And this circuit here serves as the extension and retraction circuit all in one. So this is the perfect circuit that we want for a compact circuit. We want it to be reusable. So this is actually one of the concepts of compacting. And by having a button here, it allows us to have repeatable sequences, and we can do that more easily. And yeah, this also explains why that triple piston extender, as an example, uses button inputs and also double piston extenders. Because again, you can have this observer to power the front here, and also have it to power this here via a button. And yeah. So yeah, although I say most of the triple piston extenders uses button input, but some still uses a lever input for some very peculiar reasons. They are still good, but then you wouldn't usually see a lot of triple piston extenders with lever inputs, I can say. You will see more with button inputs. Also, if you're wondering how these doors work, I'll show you. So this here, you can already see this block is pulled down. And we also have this here that controls this piston here and connects it to your hopper room, like so. And this piston is not going to push until this slime thing does its thing. And only now does this piston push. So yeah. And for this here, well, you can look at the back and see how the triple piston extender work. You can see they retract the middle pistons very nicely. This is also a reason why we need to use a wooden button. Yes, a stone button's pulse length is not long enough. We want to use a wooden button usually. So there you have it. And this also concludes that although both doors have the same pattern you already see here, the differences in the piston layout. So here we would have a slime triple thing, but then here we just have regular triples. These differences in piston layouts can change the choice of input devices and input locations drastically. So for here, the reason is that our main focus is this piston and the timings of it. So we want to have a lever here connected to a hopper rom while also powering these two pistons. But then for here, we want to solve the triple piston extender directly. So we would just have a button input here, a wooden button. And yeah, in many doors, including these two actually, the conversion between lever input to a pulse signal or a button input to a constant signal is needed. So the lever, for example, you would have this forward tick repeater here that literally does a forward tick after any lever flick. Or you will see a button here that powers these pistons constantly. So you can see they power constantly after a single button press. So again here, you see the forward tick powered after this lever turns off. And same for here, when we press the button one more time, these pistons turn off by the constant signal. Now, these techniques will be introduced in 1-6 basic circuits, monostable circuits, and 1-7 basic circuits, pulse or signal conversion. So hopefully you learn something at least from my explanation on these stuff. I know it would be kind of complex for people with little to no Redstone background, but then as you watch throughout the series, you can always come back to this video to understand more, I guess. But for those of you who understand the concepts behind it, congratulations, you basically learned something at least, and you will be well prepared for some more advanced topics. Now, good news, there are no practices today, so you don't have any work to do. And again, yeah, next video will be 1-6 basic circuits, monostable circuits. And as today's video has no practices, I wouldn't provide any road downloads actually. So I'll only provide the word file which you can refer to if you want to. But anyways, thank you for watching. I will see you in 1-6 basic circuits, monostable circuits.